Welcome back to our YouTube channel. It's your girl Fanny Lungu, back with another reaction video. If you're new to this channel, make sure to give this video a thumbs up, share it with your friends, and of course do not forget to subscribe. A big shout out to the person that suggested this. They suggested I react to I compare the teachings of Paul, Jesus, Muhammad on salvation. Is it by faith or by works or both? So without wasting time, let's get into the video.
Hello, and in this episode, I want to compare and contrast the teachings of Paul, the Apostle Paul, Jesus, and Muhammad on salvation. Is it by faith alone, or by works, or both? How do we get to heaven and avoid the punishment of hellfire? For Paul, I think, in the New Testament, the answer is straightforward. As he says in his greatest letter, the letter to the Romans, chapter 10, if you declare with your mouth, Jesus is Lord, and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For it is with your heart that you believe and are justified. It is with your mouth that you profess your faith and are saved. So clearly this is Paul telling us that we are justified, we are saved by faith alone, sola fide, as it's called in Latin. One of the great foundations of the Lutheran faith, of the Protestant Reformation, and of countless evangelicals in the world today. But there is one passage in the Gospel of Matthew that suggests, in fact, that salvation is not just a matter of belief, but also of action. An idea completely alien to the thinking of Paul. In one of the great sermons or discourses of Jesus found only in Matthew, in Matthew 25, Jesus talks about a day of judgment that will come at the end of time. The Son of Man comes in his glory with his angels, and people from all the nations of the earth will gather before him. That's Matthew 25, verse 31 onwards. And he separates humanity into two groups. As a shepherd separates the sheep from the goats, the sheep on his right and the goats are on his left. And he welcomes the sheep into the kingdom of God, prepared for you from the foundation of the world. And why are these people brought into the kingdom? Because I was hungry and you gave me food. I was thirsty and you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger and you welcomed me. I was naked and you clothed me. I was sick and you took care of me. I was in prison and you visited me. And the sheep, though, are a bit perplexed. They don't remember ever meeting Jesus, the Son of Man, let alone doing any of these things. But he tells them, just as you did it to the least of these, my brothers and sisters, so you did it to me. In other words, it is by caring for the hungry, the thirsty, the naked, the sick, and in prison that one inherits God's kingdom. The goats, on the other hand, are sent away to the eternal fire that is prepared for the devil and his angels. In other words, they go to hell. And why is this? Unlike the sheep, they didn't take care of the Son of Man when he was in need. Now, they don't remember ever seeing him either, but they saw others in need and turned their backs on them. Just as you did not do it to the least of one of these, my brothers and sisters, so you did not do it to me. And Jesus concludes his story with this statement. And these will go away into eternal punishment, but the righteous into eternal life. And these are Jesus' final public words in the Gospel of Matthew. An interesting point, if as a sort of a side point here, when Christians might think, well, surely, by the way, this passage proves that Jesus is God because he's acting as the judge of the world on the day of judgment at the end of time. You might think so, but it's just a verse here in Acts 17 where Paul is in Athens and he says about this very day of judgment, God has fixed a day on which he will have the world judged in righteousness by a man whom he has appointed. So even in this great role, Jesus is not God, that he is acting on God's behalf. God has appointed a mere man to do this job. Now, how do these words in Matthew stack up against Paul? Remember, Paul says, if you declare with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. Not so well. Paul believed eternal life comes to those who believe in the death and resurrection of Jesus. In Matthew's account of the sheep and goats, salvation comes to those who have never even heard of Jesus. If you treat others in a humane and caring way, in their need, and this is a completely different view of salvation. Now, there is another story in Matthew, which rams the point home, really. It's in Matthew's Gospel, chapter 19, where Jesus is asked, what must I do to get eternal life? This is verse 16. Teacher, what good deed must I do to have eternal life? And he said to him, why do you ask me about what is good? There is only one who is good. If you wish to enter into life, keep the commandments. And the man says, which ones? And Jesus lists some of the Ten Commandments. The man says, he insists he's already done all of these. What else does he need to do? Jesus replies that he should give up everything he owns and you will have treasure in heaven. Matthew 19, 16 to 22. Then Jesus says, and come follow me. But note this, following Jesus comes only after the man will have inherited heavenly treasure by giving everything away. So here, salvation is clearly by actions. It's not by just faith in Jesus' death and resurrection. That doesn't a feature at all. So one could wonder what would have happened if this same man had come up to Paul years later, say 20 years later, if Paul were asked how someone would have eternal life, would he have said, like Jesus, keep the commandments? If you wish to enter into life, keep the commandments. Not Paul, no way. The commandments have nothing to do with it. Jesus' death and resurrection do. Would Paul have said that giving away all he owned would earn him treasure in heaven? Not at all. Only faith in Jesus could bring eternal life. Now, some people, in my experience, have a good answer to this. They say, Jesus is talking about salvation before his death, and Paul is talking about salvation afterwards. But you can't really argue that, because Matthew was writing after Paul. Matthew is usually thought to have been written about AD 85, 90, towards the end of the first century. Paul in Romans is probably writing in the 50s. Also, in Matthew, Jesus is talking about the last judgment. Matthew 25 is about the last judgment, which obviously would take place after his death and resurrection. So we still have this problem for Christians who follow Paul. If Matthew's Jesus was right, and keeping the law and loving others as yourself could bring salvation, how could Paul be right that doing these things were irrelevant to attaining salvation and entrance into paradise? That's the problem. Now, lastly, I just want to talk about, there's a lovely hadith. Hadith is a saying of Muhammad, and there's one in Bukhari, this collection of pristine hadiths, which are all authentic, allegedly. And in one hadith, it says, Muhammad said, not one of you will enter paradise by his deeds alone. They asked, not even you, O Messenger of God? He said, not even me, unless God covers me with his grace and mercy. So, none of you will enter paradise by his deeds alone. So, this is kind of, again, a kind of middle way between Paul and Jesus. It's not in Paul's view, not following Paul, that by faith alone. It's not following Matthew's Jesus, where it seems to be by actions alone. It seems to be by faith and by deeds, but ultimately only by the grace and mercy of God. And even Muhammad, or in other words, the greatest of human beings, it doesn't enter paradise because of his goodness, because of his merit, because of his works. Ultimately, it comes down to the grace and mercy of God. So this is a fascinating comparison of three different views. And I think the problem overall here is the New Testament itself contains a fundamental contradiction between how we get to heaven. Is it by faith alone in Jesus' death and resurrection, as all of Paul's letters say, or as Jesus himself teaches in Matthew's gospel at least, is it by your actions, your care for the poor, your humane treatment of others, your love for your neighbour? On the day of judgment, that will be the criteria by which you enter paradise, whether or not you recognise the Son of Man at all. So what is the answer to this? I think we often forget, or Christians often forget, we all forget, that this book, the Holy Bible, is in fact a library of books. It was written by many, many different people over 1,000 years or more. It took many generations for the New Testament to come together in a canon, in a scripture that the church presented as its own word of God. It didn't fall down from heaven. There was a lot of controversy about which books went in, and some books went in and then came out again. If you look at the Codex Sinaiticus, you find books like the Shepherd of Hermes and the Epistle of Barnabas as holy scripture in the New Testament, which to my knowledge no Christian accepts today in 2021, but they were accepted as scripture in the early church by many people. So we have different authors, different writings, and different views. And sometimes these views agree and sometimes they don't, as you would expect in a library of books written by many different people at different times and places throughout history. So we have some contradictions, but some of these contradictions really matter. Some are trivial, like how many people went to the tomb of Jesus, you know, was it one, was it two, did Mary Magdalene, you know, yeah, what? But these contradictions between are to do with salvation, our standing before God, how we enter paradise, how we avoid the hellfire, the punishment of the devil and his angels. This is when it really matters, because it's confusing. And what do we believe? I don't know. Having read the New Testament, it's not clear. Do we follow Jesus or do we follow Paul? Was Paul wrong? Was Jesus right? Or vice versa? Muhammad's teaching in that hadith is very attractive and seems quite reasonable. It seems to bring these loose ends together in a sense of works is important, belief is important, but ultimately it's the mercy and decision of God that matters. Anyway, I'll leave that conundrum for you to ponder till next time.
Really love this. It really speaks sense. Well, to have different opinions, it seems like Muhammad puts everything together and just explains it better. But then that's not the case. The case is, what I want to ask is, so what would happen if people eliminated the New Testament? Would the Old Testament be enough for Christians? Or what do you guys actually think? Make sure to give this video thumbs up, share it with your friends, and of course, do not forget to subscribe, and I'll see you in my next reaction video.